Alrighty, good evening everyone. Thank you so much for making it out this evening. We'll probably have people coming in and out as they get here this afternoon, but we'll probably get started here. Welcome everybody. If this is your first time here, we're very happy to have you. If you're a returning member or visitor, welcome back. We're glad to see you again. My name is George. I'm the Programs Manager here at the History Center, and I'm very excited to introduce tonight's program with our guest speaker, Lindsay Morgan. Just a few notes before we get started. This is our grand finale for miniature-themed programming. We got started back in November, and it's hard to believe it's already over the run of this exhibit, but it's been 5 months of some really incredible programming and exhibits and visits, and so thank you to everyone if you had attended a previous program. And it's been a really great run, and we're not quite done yet. We have one more event coming up next week that I'll talk about at the end of this program. But for now, we're very excited to introduce our talk with Lindsay Morgan. The program will be recorded, so if you know anyone who wasn't able to make it this evening, we'll have the recording up on our YouTube channel, and everyone will get a copy of that recording sometime next week when it's finished being published. So that's something to keep in mind as well. So with all of that out of the way, it would be my pleasure to introduce tonight's guest speaker. From 2004 to 2020, Lindsay Mican Morgan served as the Thorne Room Keeper at the Art Institute of Chicago. In her role, Lindsay researched both the history of the miniature craft and its craftsmen, in particular the history of Narcissa Thorne. Over the course of her time at the Art Institute, Lindsay worked with multiple conservation departments, including the Knoxville Museum of Art, the Museum of Science and Industry, the National Toy and Miniature Museum, Gateway Museum, among others, to maintain the display rooms and develop educational relationships with other institutions. Lindsay served as the public face and voice for the Thorne Rooms at the Art Institute through audio tours, narrations, and through interviews with publications such as the New York Times, Chicago Tribune, Wall Street Journal, and many more. Lindsay would also perform inspections on the Thorne Rooms, working closely with the conservation team to make sure the collection was always in peak condition. Today, Lindsay works as a freelance researcher, completing research projects for private collections, reports and authentications on miniature rooms, and speaking on the field of miniatures in lectures and publicly broadcasted interviews. So with that, if you could all please join me in welcoming tonight's guest speaker, Lindsay Morgan.
There is always a little debate or I think young eyes coming into the galleries at the Thorne Rooms would always be a little thrown by everything was always Mrs. James Thorne, and young eyes were always like, why are we referring to her by her husband? And it, you know, explaining that that was her wish and that was kind of what was the norm at the time. But there was little rumblings that that was maybe going to change, that it would have to be okayed by the family. Certainly, I love the name Narcissa, so if we could get that included in more wall text, I would love to see that. But let's get on to, I want to talk a fair amount about my role there, as well as some wonderful experiences I have. But I think it would be good to give a tidbit of history about Narcissa and the rooms to kind of feed into what experience I had. Because a fair amount of what I did was researching not only the archives that were already at the museum, but bolstering those up, because there's a fair amount of history that hadn't been documented, and being able to try and create a fuller picture of the Narcissa and miniatures as a field of art in general was one of the kind of key joys to my position. So let's talk about little Narcissa. So she loves little things. Here's little Narcissa and also her mother and her two siblings. She had a sister who also was a significant member of the society and married into the Swift meat packing industry. So definitely still some major family members of the Swift family in the area. So there's Narcissa in her little shirloin coat, and she is in the upper left corner in the kind of yellowed sepia photo. The story goes that she had an uncle who was a rear admiral and would travel around the world and pick up little miniature objects and bring them back to her to do dollhouse play. But this collection obviously became quite extensive, and she decided to make some use out of that. But there's a little bit of history before Narcissa that I think it's a good idea to mention. There's been a lot of significant time periods where miniature collecting really was at its heyday. And why I think it's important to mention those is some of the things that Narcissa was collecting were from these earlier eras. So a really significant time period of miniature making was during the Dutch East India Trading Company. There was a new class of people who had been kind of more of a middle class, working with shipping and freighting, and all of a sudden they had a significant amount of money, and there were women who now were keeping house that hadn't been before, and one of the great hobbies of that time was making room boxes, and there's quite a few examples of these cabinet style room boxes. So this would have been a linen cover, but it's been transformed into a replica of the home that the fine lady lived at. And you actually can see the cabinet and miniature within one of the rooms with at the appropriate linens in that example. Another person that Mrs. Thorne would have definitely been influenced by is Queen Mary. Queen Mary is an avid miniature collector. Kind of notoriously so, but there's stories that other collectors, if they knew Queen Mary was coming for a visit, would have to hide their favorite miniatures, because if she made a comment like, oh, that's a very nice cabinet, or that's a very nice rug in your miniature, they obviously had to give it to the Queen, and so if you wanted to hold on to your miniatures, you had to hide them. The country of England, after World War I, rallied and wanted to showcase the craftsmanship in England as a way to kind of celebrate that the war was over. And they constructed this miniature building for the Queen as a gift. And it showcased all the finest craftspeople and companies. So everybody from Royal Belton doing plates for the Queen, two famous authors, Rudyard Kipling, made a little miniature book to go within the library of the dollhouse. There was a gallerist that both Queen Mary and Mrs. Thorne would shop for fine miniatures at. It was housed there before it got installed at the Victorian Albert. And the story was that Queen Mary saw this room and noticed this beautiful chinoiserie, black lacquered room divider within this room, and she was kind of making comments how she really liked it and kind of hinting that I would like it. And Mrs. Swan said, well, that is for your people, so I can't give you that, but she gifted her a Persian rug, apparently, instead. But she did say no. So one of the fine craftspeople that was sold at this miniature shop in London was Arthur Punt. And not only the Queen, but anybody who was looking for fine miniatures would purchase from this store. And we can see, I don't know if you can quite make it out, but on this label, this is in one of the English rooms, it's E6, had a label from the store. And there's a couple of examples where there's a maker's label on individual objects, but it's a bit rare because for the most part, especially the rooms at the Art Institute, I'll get into this a little more, but she was commissioning most of the work. There's only a few pieces that were purchased as pieces pre-made, but Arthur Klotz's shop is definitely where a fair amount of the pre-made objects are from. So this is an image of the very first room that Mrs. Thorne constructed, and this is kind of one of those legendary, we're not 100% sure if the story is exact, but the story goes that she was doing the grand European tour with her husband. And they were in Florence and found a lovely antique shop. She's already, of course, collecting miniatures, but she'd never made a room box or anything of the sort. But she found these two chandeliers and the two little side tables. And you can't really see from the photograph, but apparently these were encrusted with jewels. And when she saw them in the antique store, they were very expensive. And the gentleman, the shop owner, said that they were owned by a duchess before, or some story. And, you know, she's like, well, I can't justify this price, this is just too much. So she leaves the shop and they go home to their hotel for the night, and she can't stop thinking about that. Of course, she goes back the next day and has to buy the chandeliers, etc. But she kind of makes up her mind that if she's going to buy something so grand and so fine, that it needs to have an equally fine home of some sort. And so she comes up with the idea of creating a whole scene to showcase these chandeliers and side tables. So this was the very first room that she constructed. It's a Venetian room, and ended up being part of 12 rooms that were shown at the 1833 portion of the World's Fair. So this is the first time they were on exhibit. There was a brief stint at an art gallery downtown, but that was actually after this little portion. So the first part of the fair, they were actually shown on the streets of Paris. And I think Mrs. Thorne was a little scandalized because there's also like little peep shows and stuff on the streets of Paris. So luckily for the 1933 portion of the fair, when she constructed, there was a final 23 rooms on view at the fair, she got her own exhibition space. And it was actually near the GM factory. And this was a great, this was one of my crown glories of finding. I had tried to find a picture of the exhibition space for ages and ages and ages, and finally, with help from the Chicago, what used to be the Historical Society, but the History Museum, going through their archives, I was able to find a copy. Now we have a copy at the archives in the Art Institute, but yeah, that was a very exciting moment when I finally found a photo of the exhibition space for the actual, because I'd heard stories like, oh no, they ended up having their own room or their own space, but I could never find any documentation. But luckily I finally found the documentation of the exhibition hall. After the World's Fair, there was tons of press, and the rooms became so popular, she decided to continue the project. So those first rooms are kind of considered the first wave of Thorne rooms. She was using more collected objects that maybe the scale wasn't exactly as she would like, and that inspired her that she wanted to become even more exact with detail, and she began hiring people and finding craftspeople to do commissions of very specific objects from history that she wanted to replicate. This is all at the same time. We're not saying that, you know, there's a history of miniatures, there's, you know, people who preceded her making rooms, but she truly kind of became the queen of all this, and I'll get to that in a second. But at the same time, it's also fun to note some of her contemporaries, because there were definitely other people making miniatures at the same time. I'm sure a lot of you know Colleen Moore, who did the Colleen Moore Fairy Castle that's at the Museum of Science and Industry now. And of course, her purpose in making miniature was far different. She was a film actress, she was more about fantasy and imagining and telling kind of more fairy stuff, fairy tale stories. And then even far different of a purpose of making miniatures, but one of my favorite stories in the miniature world is Frances Glessner Lee. I just adore this story. So here's this little grandma making miniatures, and what she's really doing is she was one of the founding people to make forensic science become a thing in America. Before that, tons of crimes were happening and the cases would get dismissed because the police officers would mess up the crime scene. And so she asked the police force, like, what can I do to help? How can we help stop crime? Like, what can I do? And they said, well, we need to train our officers on how to treat the crime scene. So her solution, crime scene dollhouses. They are kind of gruesome but magical all at the same time. And they were used very professionally by forensic teams to train for decades. And they were really received as something serious. And she received honorary awards and became really known as someone who was the beginning of forensic science in America. And of course, there's something like a really charming and gruesome about them. But I think it's so amazing how varied the uses of miniatures can be. Another contemporary, kind of following more of Mrs. Thorne's path, that I got to be a part of this new exhibition was Helena Rubinstein, and she did very kind of similar collecting and putting together miniatures. And there's an exhibit going on right now in Israel that just barely was opened earlier this year. And it was really wonderful they did that call, because I had seen photographs for years, and I'm kind of trying to reach out to the Rubinstein family, but I never was getting responses from anybody. And then all of a sudden, out of the blue, I get a call from this museum that was putting on this exhibition, and I finally got to see concurrent photos that weren't just black and whites of all the rooms that she constructed. So that was wonderful to see that they were still intact, because I kind of had wondered if they had gone missing or anything. So as I said, I wanted to mention how important Mrs. Thorne was. There were other contemporaries, but she truly was one of the, certainly by mass, by how many rooms she made, but also she really stuck to one scale, except for very few examples where, like the Gothic church that needed to be a little smaller scale. She really honed the size that was as small as you could get with maintaining as much detail as you would hope to kind of express and convey. So 1 inch to 1 foot is kind of the standard, what's considered museum quality historic miniatures, and what most miniature artists work in. There are some people who like to do micro scale, which is basically a dollhouse for the dollhouse scale. But for the most part, people work in the 1 inch to 1 foot. And a lot of the time, people kind of refer to the rooms as period rooms. And there's definitely, you can't dismiss that there's a relationship to period rooms, but they're an art piece, first and foremost. But definitely there's been times where there's been some fun kind of messing with history that I'd like to always point out how sometimes history is not as solid as we like to think. So the image on the right is Mount Vernon. It's George Washington's home. And this is a more contemporary picture, probably getting close to 20 years ago now. There's a big restoration project. And of course, nowadays they have lots of equipment that they're able to do analysis of paint colors that were originally used. They went down to the first layers, and they were able to discover that the room had been quite bright blue and that there had been wall-to-wall carpet. And so they restored the room and went back to this a kind of more original color palette. Now the room on the left is the Thorne Room of Mount Vernon. But I love that this moment is documented because there was a really significant moment that happened when this was documented. There was the story goes that there is a gaggle of ladies going on a tour of historic homes in the U.S. and they were going past Mount Vernon, and it was quite in disrepair. And they were really taken aback. This is our family father. How can we let this deteriorate? We need to save this. And so there was actually a large contingency from Illinois, and they rallied and raised $1 million at that time, a significant sum. But not having the scientific equipment that we have now, they had to kind of imagine what color palette would have fit the era, and that is the palette you see here, this kind of peachy color. To me, it's an awesome moment to document because the Mount Vernon would have fallen into greater disrepair and never would have probably seen its rendition back to something more original without this force of women coming to save Mount Vernon. So I think it's a great moment to have documented, but it is also interesting how we perceive history differently in different lenses frequently. So I want another element that I researched extensively was the craftspeople who worked for Mrs. Thorne. And one of the people she worked very closely with was Edwin Clark. He is an architect. I know this is kind of like he's being a maybe person here, but it was the best photo of him, so excuse that. See, that was way later in life than when he worked with Mrs. Thorne. But the photo you see here is one of the bigger projects that he worked on with her. And this was her home in Santa Barbara. And we'll get to some interiors in a moment, but the other big project was all the levels and designs for the Thorne Room. So for the second set of rooms, he made detailed architectural drawings and had his firm do these drawings that would show the layout of the room, the floor plan, and how the room would basically all the wall molding in detail. So really an extensive project taken very seriously. It wasn't, you know, hodgepodge together. It was really seriously taken. And as always, I love to show. So this is the interior of the Santa Barbara home that he designed for Mrs. Thorne. But I love like how you can see it. Like she loved all this Georgian English design. And like here's a Thorne Room that's that same love of hers. And you know, frequently people will ask, you know, is there a room that she's replicated? And often there will be rooms that she is taking inspiration from, but she rarely would like one-for-one copy rooms. She was more interested in what the idea of that design is and making the most full picture of what that design style is and encompassing it. And I think it's always important to realize in the theatrical way, because three walls, being able to convey a full room in three walls is a really great design ability to have an eye to be able to create an effect of a full room within just three walls. He also worked on her Lakeshore Drive home, the library within that. I believe they had the whole top floor was the Thorne residence. And then some of the design for their home up here in the forest. This is, I don't know if any of you visited, this is the Thorne home, not far from the Green Bay Road. Another amazing craftsperson was Brumdale, and he had he was an engineer, and he had his own engineering company, but then the Depression hit and his company failed. And for the most part, Mrs. Thorne, I think a lot of people will talk about like that she was very charitable, she had many charitable organizations, but she was truly looking for the finest craftspeople. So she wasn't hiring like paupers off the street or anything like this. These were like top-notch people, but of course even top-notch people during the Depression were making far less than they would normally, and she was making sure that they were being paid an appropriate amount. Brundell did some amazing pieces within the rooms. The pagoda style, this is kind of a chinoiserie English room that has a pagoda style bed that was based off of a bed in the V&A. And then this is an illustration from the Chippendale handbook that he replicated for the rooms. Another individual that I was very, very lucky to get to meet, and was the last living person to have worked on anything in the Thorne Rooms, here I'll go back to that in a second, is Lee Meisinger. She constructed over 101 of the rugs within the Thorne miniature rooms. And here's one of the examples. She would work from just diagrams that would just give outlines. It wouldn't give stitch numbers or anything. She had to kind of figure that out herself and was able to do that. She continued. Here's a little example that we use in the, actually the gallery has a display of some of the craftspeople. And I was able to go, she lived in Fond du Lac, Wisconsin, and I was able to go up and visit her and interview her, and about a year later she passed away. She also was cousin to the gentleman on the left, who was Eugene Kupchak. So she began work, I'll go back here, because the Needlework and Textile Guild of Chicago, who actually did most of the work at Art Institute for the Textile Department, Mrs. Thorne was asking them to do these rugs, and they did a couple, and then they're like, give us someone to train. We have tapestries to repair, but we'll train someone, and then they can continue the project. So that's Eugene suggested his cousin, who was just fresh out of high school, and began constructing these rugs. She done a little bit of needlework and continued the rest of her life. She made all the rugs for the Kupchak and then Hank Kupchak swings until she passed away. Doing all this research, also I became quite close with Hank Kupchak, and we were able to work on doing a couple of loans of some of their rooms. The bottom left is a room that he created for the Marshall Field family, And this was a really fun room to borrow because quite a few of the objects within this room had, after the miniature had been made, had then been gifted to the Art Institute, the full-scale objects. So this was kind of a little documentation of their collection. It's not a replica of their house, but it's a replica of full-scale objects that they owned, that they knew they would be eventually donating, and they wanted kind of a little keepsake to remember those objects in miniature. So we were able to display this room and then have like little links to what gallery to go see the full-scale object in person. So that was a really fun room to borrow for as a loan for about a year. And then the German Hall here had been a room that was originally shown with the collection but had gone off view. So that was lovely to get that back on view for a few years. Another amazing artist, because not only was it craftspeople that Mrs. Thorne was hiring, she was also finding artists who were doing amazing things in their field. So this is Zimmerman, who was a metalsmith artist, doing a lot of enamel work and whatnot. And the kind of quirky connection to Zimmerman is that the Thorne family had hired her to create the crypt gates at their mausoleum, which you can see at the Rose Hill Cemetery. And the work is just stunning, the metal work. And so Mrs. Thorne hired her to create the side chapel metal work in the Gothic church. That's one of the miniature rooms. And also in the Gothic church, there was an artist who usually created quite large scale pieces of work. Often quite civic buildings. She did major pieces for the Kansas City Railway Station, St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York. She did a beautiful mosaic that's on the altarpiece. Here's another one of her pieces that's done in marble. There's three larger, about 14 foot wide medallions on the Arcadia building that she created. And for the Gothic Church, she did a triptych. Let's see a little closer detail at the back of the church. And she also did the designs for a tapestry that's in the Paris ring. So, some of the things I do. I think every time a news agency would come and visit it, I would want to talk about something, and they'd be like, can you dust? So, I did dust, but I don't know that I dusted quite as much as the news agencies would want. It always, the dusting. And they always want me to be dusting the room with the furniture, and I'm like, I don't, that's not how I dust. I take everything out, but I have to just, you know. It was more exciting, I suppose, than having me just talking about the rooms, having me dusting things. But I always like that. I try and be presentable because I was going to be on some, you know, filmed or something. But it always would remind me because I, you know, normally I would not be dusting with, like, you know, a little sequiny dress on or something. But it always reminds me of this wonderful photo of Mrs. Thorne, you know, making miniatures with her pearl necklace on, and I love that. I was like, I'm kind of okay with wearing my little cocktail dress and dusting away, because it just reminded me how, you know, she was best dressed always in the newspaper all the time, the society paper. She always would get best dressed, so I couldn't ever aspire to quite that well dressed, but I like to at least. So usually how I would be dealing with objects is I myself or the team of the usually objects conservation, but then I might need to work with paper conservation or textiles conservation, we would take the object into the lab, and if there was anything going on, in this case, an arm on this candelabra would come on, it had a weak solder point. And so we cleaned off the metal head, started kind of weak, and it was potentially going to cause corrosion. So you're removing the old solder. In almost all cases, we wouldn't repair it as it would have been made. We would use a reversible glue. So if we decided in the future that something else needed to happen, that it was basically easily removed and could be contended with without causing any damage. Other things, whenever I was dealing with the exhibition or bringing in loan rooms, doing assessments of the individual objects. So here's Hank, and this is Susie Schneck, who used to be the head of the Objects Conservation Lab. We would inspect and take photographs and analyze the object to make sure we were keeping it as it came in and being ready to, when it returned, to make sure it was in the same shape. I loved working at the lab with the objects conservation. This was a project. There were times where I would decide that it was better if one of the objects conservationists maybe had more experience in like glue removal. I would let them do that. Then there might be a situation in the case of this chandelier. There was some of the chain had come undone, and there was some tarnishing that I was able to do. The metal working was in micro scale, so I had enough experience working in metal and miniature that we decided that my hands were the right choice for this project. One of my favorite conservation projects was usually when you're dealing with museum level conservation, you tend to try and stabilize whatever is there and make it look as best as possible without changing the original object. With the miniature rooms, that has not always been the case because of their nature. Usually with textiles, you only leave textiles up for a short time, and then you need to rotate them out or else they deteriorate. But you have to have curtains 24/7 in a miniature room, so that isn't always spot on. So we try to either replicate or find matches, and then we hold on to the originals for research purposes. But the curtains and whatnot have been changed over the years. One other case, the other thing to note is all the rooms traveled extensively after their first foray. The rooms that are now at the Art Institute, they went to the San Francisco World's Fair, they traveled to different museums. So there's dings and dents in some of those backdrops that, have been there a long time. And doing repairs on some of those things were like finding old damage, deciding what to do. So there was a clock that had long been making me sad that was missing a finial. And there was a gentleman named Bill Robertson that I've studied with quite a few times. He gave an online speech that he talked to your group a few weeks ago, like 2 weeks ago or something, yeah. And he is honestly one of the top-notch miniaturists of our day and age. He makes things that function like fishing poles and like skates with keys and just amazing pieces. And I studied with him quite a few times to practice, and I like to go and do little workshops with people at this level, just making sure my hands stayed nimble and I could practice on something that wasn't historic Thorne Room object, and I could feel confident in when I did need to handle them or inspect them that I had a comfort level of what pressure, what thing, the strength of wood, how skinny it was. It was a great resource to be able to study with these different miniature artists. So this is a workshop I took with Bill Robertson. It was, the purpose of the class was learning how to replicate on a lathe, trying to make exact matches, and we were doing candlesticks to try and make sure we could try to make a pair that were identical. My purpose, here you can kind of see me working through making candlesticks. But what I really was taking the class for was being able to practice over and over and over again, trying to replicate these shapes on a lathe, because this little clock was missing its brother, finial. So I was able to replicate, and then obviously here, this is very shiny brass instead of the, so we used a wax method that helps kind of basically patina start, and you let it sit out and oxidize for a bit, and then you wipe it off and it gets to a point and is level. So we were able to match the finial pretty well, and now it gets to live its life. And of course, that's all documented, so it's known that the object has been added, and you leave little markers to let it be known, what's original and what's not. But that was a really fun question. There was quite a few times where it was really just wonderful to have that resource of reaching out to other miniature artists, being able to see insights on how they construct things and compare it to any notes we had about how the Thorne Rooms were made. And luckily there's people who are so into the historical craft, and Bill Robertson has the hugest tool collection I've ever seen, and if you wanted a tool that was from the era that Mrs. Thorne was working, or in the case of, for one of the holiday events, there was, we wanted to replicate a wassail bowl that was made on a 17th century lathe, and of course we had one. So you just always had goofy stuff to help out. Another fun project I got to work with, the author Marianne Malone, she, it was kind of funny when it first came to light that there was going to be this book by a Random House book coming out that was inspired by the Rooms. There's all this hubbub in the director's office, and do you know about this? What is going on? And I'm like, this is a surprise to me too. There had been one volunteer who mentioned to me that 3 years previously there was a lady who came in and she was kind of talking about making a book, and that was it. That's all we heard. And all of a sudden, next thing you know, plop, there's an advanced reader mailed to the museum. And so it was pretty funny. When I first spoke with her, the director's office was really worried because there's lots of talk about the kids are a little bit naughty and sneak behind security and things, and they were worried that security secrets were being divulged. But so I had to hurry and overnight read this book really quick, and I'm like, oh, I can see this is all she just observed what was going on. There's things that are off, that that's not how that really works, so that's not how that lock works. She's just imagined this, so I don't, she wasn't telling anybody how to break into the museum or anything. But then finally I got to speak with her, and she's like, you probably are thinking I'm going to ask you for behind the scenes tour. And she's like, I don't want one because I want to keep it in my imagination. I don't want what I imagined to be ruined. And I'm like, okay, that's fine by me. But then over the years we started doing fun programs together. There was 3 books in the end, and we started doing programs where she'd come in and do a writing workshop for kids, and then I did some hands-on constructing shadow boxes for kids and stuff. It was really wonderful to work with her, and definitely it was wonderful to have the rooms talked about in a book that, you know, was published across the world. So that was a fun little happenstance that happened. Then, of course, you know, I mentioned you know, the press. There were some really fun special projects that came up, some through artists. There was a gentleman who was a filmmaker who did all these amazing panning film shots of the rooms, and it was right when Chimageddon was happening, like the freeze. And so I was coming to work every morning in like snowsuits, and it was perfect because the galleries were just like nearly empty, so we'd close off little sections, but there would hardly be anybody there anyways, and we just filmed for like 3 days all these beautiful shots of these panning shots of the rooms. And then there was a New York Times piece that came out by the photographer James Casper, and that was a really fun photo project to work with too. And it was often fun because I had to do some wacky. I worked enough with having the rooms photographed that they're quite hard to photograph because honestly the way to view the rooms truly is the gallery lights should be totally next to off, if not off, and your eyes will adjust to the room immediately then. But of course there's OSHA standards, so they at some point raised up the gallery lights, so it's, you have to kind of stand there for a while and kind of like let your eyes adjust. But when photographers would come in, they'd always be struggling because the lights would be the backdrop lights are frequently hard to photograph, and so I'd always be like, can I help a little? And I had this rice paper that I could slide on the backdrop lights, and that would always help tone down the lights a little bit. And another really amazing artist project that I got to participate in was during the, a couple of years ago with the Chicago Architecture Biennale, there was an exhibit that was all influenced on the Thorne Rooms, and they asked if I'd work with a architecture studio from Mexico City and come up with a project to do in one of the rooms. So this is the very large scale model that was at the cultural center. And then what was funny is at first they kind of were like, well, maybe we could put like an architectural drawing in one of the rooms. And I'm like, oh, that's kind of boring, you know. And they're like, well, what we really wanted to do is have a miniature model of our model. And but they're like, we tried to go to 3D printers and they said it was impossible. And I'm like, you need to go to a miniaturist. And so I sent them to this gentleman who doesn't, he lives in Illinois, and he makes very kind of retro-y Nice Van Roo furniture and other, he has worked with plastics a fair amount and bent metal and whatnot. And I'm like, I know he can do it for you. So, and they looked at his work and were like, would be perfect. So they commissioned this miniature artist, and there for a couple months we had a miniature, and we felt that the fun San Francisco, very artsy room was a great fit for having more artwork within the space temporarily. So it was always fun when we were able to work with contemporary artists that were really inspired by the room. That was a great example of, you know, really serious architects all being like reaching out and being like, we want to do something with the Thorne Rooms. We're all inspired by them. And it's always really great to hear how you know, artists and you know, serious people were really inspired by these rooms. Because I know every now and again you get someone being a little poopy. way. You could be both. It's true. So this is a really fun picture. I'll kind of talk about a little bit of Mrs. Thorne's charity and some fun projects I had to work with involving her charity work. So this is a picture of a group of gals from the WAC, the Women's Athletic Club. They call themselves the Glitter Girls. And every holiday season they get together and do kind of a craft fair and sell things for charity. And Mrs. Thorne helped them on quite a few occasions do room boxes that would be up for auction. And that kind of would conjoin with some of the rooms that she would make for the Women's Exchange, which was little teas would be put on, and then people would gather and bid on room boxes and various other things. Here's some of the examples of the things that would have been sold at the Women's Exchange. More shadow boxes, or boxes that, like the examples in the gallery, that have little seams of paper cut out, and this is sort of collected illustrations and travel prints extensively, and had no qualms about snipping something up to make one of these shadow boxes. And then one of her other huge charities is from herself and her husband started what is now the Northwestern Nursing Program. And you can still to this day in the nursing school see the plaque that they started the program. The idea of charity and holidays kind of came to a culmination in ideas of programming back, goodness, how many years ago would it be at this point? Probably about 9 years ago. I was asked to help come up with an idea of something to do in the rooms during the holidays. And at first I was talking about things outside of the rooms, things, events and things, and then the CEO was like, why not in the rooms? And I'm like, I need to think about that for a while. I didn't want to step on Mrs. Thorne's toes. I didn't want to, obviously I never would want to do anything to damage the rooms. I knew it was a huge thing to do with full-scale period rooms. You go to a historic home and whatnot, and they'll do things in the period or whatever. I'm like, these aren't really period rooms. These are our pieces. But I spoke with her granddaughter, and she said, she wanted to do that. She was planning on doing that for years and just never got the okay from the museum. And so I was like, okay, let's do it. So we started originally, and I have to admit, I never really liked this name, but it was called Home for the Holidays. It became like Gifts to the City eventually. But the idea was to create a big event that was a destination for coming to the museum. So there was the creche, and then there would be the decorated Thorne rooms. It was quite an undertaking because I was given pretty free rein. So I would propose, the first year was 6 rooms I had to come up with and how to commission and make anything that was going within the rooms. One of the first year's rooms, I really wanted to do this room, and then it became, there was quite a few rooms I wanted to do, and there'd be a double challenge. So this is kind of a room decorated, but I'll come back to that. The challenge of some of these rooms is they were a long season outside. So we had to replicate the backdrop for this is the Pennsylvania Dutch room. And then construct the replica of the backdrop. So there was a few rooms that we had to do that, and that was a huge ordeal. But the fun part of this project is another pair of amazing miniature, contemporary miniature artists who just live up near the Brookfield Zoo, are out, Allison and Steve Ashby, and they started doing historic miniatures. Kind of, the husband was a full scale architect and did restorations on historic places. So he had worked at a Frank Lloyd Wright house and asked the owner if he could make a replica of this like little breakfast nook, and you know she okayed it, and so that was kind of his first foray into miniatures, and then it went huge from there. He continued on making tons of historic miniatures. There's a museum called the Gateway Museum down in Gateway Museum in, no, it's down in, I know, Gateway, you would hope, like, it's in Tennessee, and it will pop in my head in a minute. Kay Browning is the director, or she, like, it's her collection, and she's the director of but it's basically a replica of her hometown, like, all that, the movie house, how it used to be, and all that, and they constructed pretty much this whole miniature museum. So I spoke with them and talked about how I was working on this Pennsylvania Dutch room. I wanted to make a pair of ice skates. And this wonderful woman who had a huge ice skate collection helped me. I was like, okay, I need something from this era. I wanted to have something interesting, and she sent me back images of this amazing pair of skates that were made from a pair of files, and then turned into a prow, turned into like a swan neck. So we made a miniature. I love whenever these projects get to go and visit the miniature artist that I was commissioning and get to work with them. So it was really fun because I got to actually be there in their studio and we worked together and, you know, doing little miniature anvils and like using like tiny blow torches and the whole gamut. It was super fun. And here they are in the scene. So that's a pile of, it's actually deer fur, but it's straw because the Dutch really got hay for the donkey that the baby, the Christkind, the baby Jesus, would come and get the hay. And the little Dutch, the little cart shoes. So one of the last projects I got to work on was kind of more the angle I had wanted to go the whole time. So the old director of the museum had retired and kind of pushing the idea of Mrs. Thorne as an artist instead of these being period rooms. It was getting harder to kind of meld those ideas with Dewey and these decorated period rooms. And I came across, there was this series of photographs that through my research I had to come across. And they're now, as you can see, this is a box from the archives that we have it was like a mysterious photo album that just said dolls' houses. Luckily, I knew enough of the stories that I realized what this amazing set of photos was. It was a series of photos of dolls' houses that Mrs. Thorne constructed to be gifts for the children that were coming to basically the children's hospital. So there are all these amazing dolls' houses for the children to play with during their stay. And she also made little laptop versions for children who were bedridden. So I decided for the last year that we did a holiday project, I wanted to replicate one of these doll houses and that it would go within one of the rooms as kind of a nod to Mrs. Thorne's charity, and also something that truly was related to her and her artistry, and not just replicating something from a historical. So I talked about how some miniature artists, you know, most of them work in around 12 scale. There are some who work in smaller scale, which is dollhouse size. So I, you know, a wonderful woman named Mel Corkin, who indeed does work in dollhouse size. And here she is working on a little Tudor house in the same. So I can kind of see this photo. I made like a paper maquette with the scale and general layout of what I imagined, you know, the scale down of one of those hospital dollhouses would be within one of the dorm rooms, and then we began constructing the actual sketches of the layout and the different levels and designs for how the room would be constructed. And she was up in Michigan, so I took a train up there to work with her for a few days because she had all the tiny tools, and all my tools were just like 12 tools, so it was easier just to go to her studio. So we worked together for a few days constructing this little dollhouse, and then it went into our Victorian, our Indiana or Middletown parlor room. Oh, because there was also because there's already some toys in that scene, so it felt fitting for it to go within that room, as well as being the only Midwest room in the former collection. And it's been that she would not have thought it was a great design. It would have been more like, oh, this is like my grandma's house. So we like that. And then I mentioned her granddaughter. That's a great photo of her. So this is at the Santa Barbara home. And there's Mrs. Thorne holding her granddaughter. And this idea of dollhouse continues on through her granddaughter. I got to work with her. She had a dollhouse that Mrs. Thorne had constructed for her. And she was retiring and wanting to downsize, and she wasn't quite sure what to do with this dollhouse. She didn't have room for it. And you know, she was like, well, can you give it to like the kids department and the kids can just play with it? I'm like, no, let's find a suitable home for this, so we'll be able to have a long life. And I knew that there wasn't really a home at our institute for a display, except maybe something temporary. So I'm like, let's find something more permanent. And there's a museum in Kansas City, Missouri, called the Toy and Miniature Museum. And it has an extensive collection of miniatures, and I called them, and they're like, this is the most perfect timing ever. We're just about to do an exhibition on dollhouses, and we'd love to have something that Mrs. Thorne did to connect even further to the miniature collection. So here's a great picture. Actually, this house is Twin Manors by William Robertson, who I've studied with many times. So they have just a really amazing top-notch collection of miniatures there. And being able to find a permanent home for Mrs. Thorne's granddaughter, Anne Thorne Weaver, was great to know that it would have a long life. And then my most recent research project was this Cuffell Cottage came up right before COVID hit. I had received an email about someone kind of wanting to ask questions about this room, and then it all fell apart, and we were all sent home from the museum for months and months, and it kind of went to the back of my mind, and I assumed, who knew what happened to it. Well, eventually it was purchased, and then the individual took it to a miniature exhibition, and the Kansas City, the Thorne Miniature Museum reached out to me and asked if I could authenticate this room and provide any history of the room. Luckily, I had remembered it coming up to auction, but I also knew the individual who had originally, the auction house, it didn't know any history about the room, and the individual who was selling it didn't know any history of the room. I luckily remembered the room had actually been in one of the original catalogs from when the rooms toured to the World's Fairs. It had been part of the earlier collection of rooms, and I was able to go to the library archive and pull up the documentation of the room, you know, having been part of that collection. So frequently I'd get calls or people who had little shadow boxes and whatnot that were from the charitable auctions that Mrs. Thorne would take part in. But rooms that had been on exhibition at museums pretty much next to never came up. So the you know, being able to find this room and save it was really a great pleasure. There's a few rooms out there that I always hope someone will reach out, and there was an amazing room that Mrs. Thorne had helped to create. It was at a field hospital. That was like a nursing training piece that for World War II, the nurses could learn how to, where everything would be kept in a field hospital. I would love to see that piece come to light if it exists anymore. So whenever one of these comes up for auction or comes back to public view, it's wonderful that it's not just hidden away or thrown away anymore. So that was my latest project that I got to work on. And I would love to answer any questions that you guys have. If you want to.
Would the museum ever consider putting magnetic glass in the displays?
Yeah, there was the trick with the glass is the frames are the original frames. There's only so much accommodation, and so they could either get non-shatter or the non-glare. But now there is glass that could do both and be thin enough, but honestly those old frames have a lot of issues. They, the locking mechanisms, they're like for keys for like your apartment, like ancient apartment, like mailbox. They're not, you know, they're not a museum. They need to all be done with. We talked about doing magnetic locks, but because there's 68 rooms on view, to do locking mechanisms for each individual room would be beyond exorbitant. So otherwise, you can either maybe do a few banks, or if you had all of them, they'd all be open, or they'd all be closed. So being able to access if something tipped over or you need to do maintenance when the museum's open would become a real problem. So there was always a lot of, between conservation and then the locksmiths, there was always like a big battle about what the best option was. And the glass was kind of part of that as well. But it was really just in the last few years that there was an option. And there's talk towards the end of my time being there, I was really pushing for a that gallery refresh. Really needed to happen. The carpet in there was horrendous, and the textured wall and everything was, you know, like the design was very not like early 90s, and everything was getting a little more worn down, and we were going back and forth whether there was just going to be a refresh or the department head was actually really pushing to move the gallery to a totally new location and do a whole new design layout. And Some of the ideas I didn't love, quite honestly, and the location, although more prime in one way, is the gallery that's kind of the right above the library that had the folk art. In written description, it sounds more like it's not in the basement, great, it's more prime, but actually, being right at the base of the grand staircase and right by the bathroom was actually prime real estate. It sounds goofy, but it's true. I mean, it might have been basement, but the foot traffic was huge. And of course, the Thorne Rooms are forever going to be popular. But I feel like that was more hidden away location than being at the base of the grand staircase. So I don't know what they'll end up doing, but there was some major talk about a gallery refresh, and then they would address issues of doing better glass, because yes, totally, the glare was always obnoxious. But also, the big thing to me is they weren't meant to be viewed in the light, and there wouldn't be the glare if the lighting was done more properly in the gallery space. So that's also something that hopefully will eventually be addressed as well.
I realize there's lots of different rooms, but could you take one room and what would a price tag be, or priceless? I mean,
yeah, it's really hard to say because, I mean, that room that came up, that was Costello Cottage, that was one of the earlier rooms, and so that isn't even considered at the level of the rooms that are on view in the gallery. Like, the thing that I think is to note, the in the 60s when Mrs. Thorne was kind of coming towards the end of her life and she was thinking about what a success to rooms were, and she talked about how there's no way she could have constructed them again because of the costs would have been far too much in that by the 60s. So I can tell you when we looked into when the Irish exhibition came through the Art Institute, my colleagues and I talked about doing a miniature room for one of the major donors, kind of inspiration for doing the Irish exhibition. We were like, it'd be amazing if we did a miniature replica of his hall. And I forewarned them. I'm like, okay, do you want like a little shadow box? Do you want a full room? They're like, yeah, we want a full room. I'm like, what are you prepared to pay? Because I can tell you it's not going to be cheap. And, they're like, oh, maybe $20,000. And I talked to a bunch of artists, and they all were giving very lovely prices, and the lowest you could get it to was $70,000. And that was with skimping on some objects that we would have really wanted. And that's also with them being like, we'll give you a good price because artists would like to have their pieces in a museum. But to do the actual forms and then add on the value of their historic significance and that they were made by this, Chicago icon, it's hard to really say a price. But the tricky thing is also, I was talking earlier with George about the room boxes can be a little challenging though on the secondhand like auction market because most collectors collect very specific things and a lot of them like individual objects and room boxes there's like this mindset people always like where do I put this big thing and what's funny is people collect like hundreds of miniatures but they take up way more room but then the room box, like, oh, it's so big, what do I do with it? So it does have a little narrower market than individual miniature objects are really desirable and can go for exorbitant amounts of money. The rooms themselves, yeah, it's hard to say, but I mean, we can gauge off of some of the cup check rooms, and they're usually well over 100 and upwards of 250, and that's can come up and see what it would go for. Departments to also lecture staff membership, the PR and marketing department, and then getting to work with the education department, working with coming up with programs for adults and children. It was just really fun. And then, so being able to get to go and do these study programs with different miniature artists. Sometimes I'd be gifted something personally, but then it was a little hard when I was leaving because there were some things that I, had taken a class that was, I was working, and those I felt it was, I left them, but I was like, I hope they don't just get thrown away or something. So there was a few things that I was pretty bummed to leave behind that it didn't feel ethical to take them with me, because it was something I constructed as part of my studies for the rooms. But things that I did kind of on my own time, I have a few books. I worked with this wonderful woman from the Netherlands who constructs these very, they are made as a true, book binding techniques. She has an amazing person who does really traditional book printing that does everything in the right scale, and it's just so crisp, and you hold them out of a fine glass and you can read that book in miniature. So I worked with her a few times to learn how to construct books in miniature, and a couple of times I made some miniature books just with some of the techniques that she taught me on it. So those are in my collection. Those are some favorite objects. There's a woman from South Africa who does birds, and I did, she sometimes would do workshops if she needed to try out a workshop, and she invited me to come a couple of times, and so I did that as a little side vacation. So I have a couple of the little birds I made with her. Trying to think what furniture objects I have left. Sadly, there's a few really cool furniture pieces that are just probably stored in a box somewhere in my old office. Especially, there's a beautiful chair with a woven seat that took forever to make. That was really fun. And that gentleman's really amazing. He's from Oregon. His name's Mark Murphy, and he's going to be, there's a PBS show called American Crafts, or it's something about American artistry, craftsmanship, that's kind of a newer series, and he's going to be in an upcoming episode coming up soon, so that will be fun. No, I only did shadow boxes ever. I thought about a couple of times about making full-scale rooms. There was a few workshops with that. I did make a replica. This was, again, I had my own side artist career. And I did a piece that was replicating my parents' bed that I grew up with them having, which was a water bed. Four-postered water bed that I constructed in 1/12 scale. So yeah, there's a few pieces that I constructed for our pieces that were in exhibitions and fairs and whatnot. So that's a pretty fun one. If any of you are super inspired to check out more miniatures or get involved with more miniatures, there is a couple of big miniature shows / I assume they still have classes ahead of time. They used to always have the week preceding little workshops you could take, but there's a few different ones that are all at the same time, but the kind of first one that started was the Tom Bishop miniature show that comes to Chicago. It's usually right by the Cumberland Blue Line stop. It used to be out in Schaumburg, but now I think it's still at near the Cumberland stop. But miniature artists from around the world not everything's going to be miniature, like museum quality, but there are definitely some artists there that are museum quality, but then there'll also be like, I want to get furniture or tchotchkes for my granddaughter's dollhouse. It will have that whole level. So everything from really fine collectibles to just more, you know, approachable, fun things for kiddos to play with. So that's a fun, like, you know, Saturday afternoon adventure of checking out some, hundreds of miniatures till your eyes pop out.
As I mentioned, this is our final miniatures program, but I did say there was one more event that we have coming up that's miniatures focused, and that's next week, Thursday. We have a private tour scheduled to visit the Museum of Science and Industry to get a presentation on Colleen Moore's Fairy Castle that Lindsay Morgan talked about. So that's a private tour limited to 15 people. There are still spots open. We say that it's for our membership, but if you're not a member, you can always sign up for that tour, then confirm a membership later. But that's a really cool, one-of-a-kind opportunity. Parking and admission is compensated for the rest of the day. Get to speak to the curators, and they're actually pulling out some artifacts from their archives that aren't on display that you can take a look at that are connected to the castle. So if you're looking for more miniature-themed programming, that's our last thing that we're doing for the year. But then also Lindsay talked about William Robertson and Francis Glessner Lee's nutshell studies. We had programs with both Bill Robertson last week and William Tyre from Glessner House that have some of the nutshell studies rooms. He was here in the middle of March. And so both of those programs were recorded. So if you want to watch those, you can visit the History Center YouTube channel and you can watch those for free. The same place where Lindsay's presentation from tonight will be uploaded. Again, thank you to everybody for coming out this evening. If you're a member, thank you for being a member.